What's up, guys? Welcome to Core Conversations. This is your boy, Wilfred Williams. Today, I have with me QPR legend, Niko Hämäläinen, one of my favorite people. We go way, way, way back. Niko, welcome to the podcast, bro. I'm excited to have you, bro.
Thank you. Thank you for having me, bro. It's been a long time. Very, very long time.
I know, bro. It's been a very long time since, like, 2014, I'll say, bro.
Yeah, probably 2014. Yeah.
Goodness. We were kids. We were kids back then. Can you believe that, bro?
Literally, kids.
We were kids. Yeah. Like, I mean, it's crazy to think about. So, guys, I'm excited about this. I'm excited to have my boy here. We've been trying to do this for a while, and I'm so happy that we're able to do this. And with his busy schedule, you know, right now they're in season. So it's great that, you know, we're here. So today, right, I have some awesome cool workout for Niko. And then, you know, we're going to dive into some of his playing career and some, and then so we can learn a little bit about Niko. So our first workout today, it's going to be the shoulder taps. Okay. So you're going to be in here in this plank position. Okay. And you're going to go just here, shoulder taps, okay? And then the next one is going to be a single leg drop, okay? And so you're here, legs is up, single leg drop, and just come down, okay? Third one is going to be a bird dog, okay? So you're here, knee, leg out, opposite arm, opposite leg, bring it into the elbow, back out, switch leg, switch arm, switch leg, opposite arm, opposite leg, in, and then out. Okay, you're gonna, and then the next one, the fourth one, it's gonna be a runner sit up. You're here, sit up, boom, sit up like you're running. Keep that forearm like you're running. Okay, fifth one, it's gonna be a beast, knee to elbow, so you're here, knees hover over the ground. Okay, knees to elbow. This is a killer one here. Knees to elbow. Okay, the sixth one is going to be a toe touch to a full sit up. Okay, so you're here. Okay, toe touch, boom, into full sit up. Can you try to sit up as tall as you can? Back in, take a toe touch, back in. Whew. Last one, this is going to be Niko's favorite right here. You're going to have here into your plank position, like you're about to do a push-up. Okay, you're going to turn into a side plank, knee drive, back in, reverse, turn all the way, side plank, knee drive. That's the 7 core workout we got for you today. And so we're going to be doing each of them for 30 seconds, have like a 15-second rest in between. And then we will do them for 2 rounds, okay? 2 rounds, 15 seconds rest, 30 seconds working. You ready, Niko?
Yes, sir.
Everybody got the water?
I got water.
Got his drink? All right. All right, here we go. So you're going to hear, Niko, you're going to hear this sound, okay?
Warm up for 2 minutes.
Okay, so you're going to hear that ring. That means we're working. The bell's ringing, that means we're working. And then you're going to hear this, the siren.
Recover for 15 seconds.
You're going to hear recover for 15 seconds, and then so we stop. But I'll let you know 5 seconds ahead before it's time to recover.
Okay.
Okay. And but before we get started, let's do some cat-cows. So we can warm up that spine. So we're ready to work out. Get some cow-cows in there. Boom. Just warm up the spine a little bit. Ooh. Did you have training today?
Yeah, bro.
Oh, man. How was that?
It was all right. It was a recovery day because we had, second day recovery day because we had a game on Tuesday night.
Okay, here we go. Let's do some cobra. So you're here, on the ground, and you just lift up this. Good. And it's just some child's pose. Open up that knee a little bit, and let's just get the lower back. Nice little warm up before, you know, get into this workout. All right. Okay. Ready?
Yeah, ready, bro.
All right. Okay. Let's get it.
Warm up for 2 minutes.
Working in 3, 2, 1. Let's go. Shoulder taps. So when did you get into playing football? How did you get into it?
When I could walk, run, maybe 1, 2 years old.
Jeez.
Yeah, bro. I think it was kind of I was just born into it. I just enjoyed it from young.
Recover for 15 seconds.
So you got started at a really young age. Yeah. I remember your pops plays as well, right?
Yeah, I used to when
obviously used to walk. Yeah, used to play.
Yeah, he played in Finland.
Okay.
He played in the UEFA Cup.
Wow.
But for a Finnish team back in the day.
Okay.
But yeah, I think it's kind of a thing where I was just born into it type of thing. Like I just enjoyed it from young. He obviously introduced me to football, soccer, but
yeah.
Obviously if you don't like something, like he's not gonna force you to actually like it. But I loved it, so I think I just got into it from early.
Yeah, bro. Yeah, I mean I remember here we go. Next one, you ready?
Yeah.
Single leg drops. So we're on our backs. Okay. I remember hearing the story a little bit about your dad, how he played. I mean, it's just amazing, you know, seeing you fall in this process. Here we go, working 3, 2, 1. Here we go, leg drops. I mean, at what point did you realize that playing pro was the dream, or that you had the potential to play?
3 seconds until recover.
I'll probably say
15 seconds.
There you go.
I'll probably say maybe just playing. When I was younger, I always played a couple age groups up. Like, when I was, like, 8 years old, I remember playing against, like, under 12s and under 13s and stuff. And I was doing my thing in those games.
Yeah.
So I think just obviously playing age groups up and me still being able to handle my own, even though they were bigger and stuff.
Right.
I think people around me kind of noticed, like, oh, if he's doing it, like, against a couple year older players, that means that he might have good potential. And, yeah, I think just from that, then people around me that my dad knew through football as well.
Yeah.
Kind of that also played professionally. That have that obviously eye for the game and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I think they kind of took a notice of the potential, I guess you could say, I could have.
Yeah. And so was that always the dream of, like, I want to play pro? Like, was Did your dad have he probably had an influence on your reason of like you trying to go pro.
Yeah, I think so. But at the same time, he didn't really, like, he's never forced me or, like, he knows what I had to do to get, if I wanted to become a professional myself, he knew the sacrifice and the hard work you have to do to get there. But
right.
At the same time, he didn't force me to do it, if you get what I mean. Like, it was kind of my own will, my own mentality that, yeah, this is what I want to do. I remember always when I was younger, waking up, like on a Saturday and Sunday, waking up and watching Premier League games on TV. And I was always thinking to myself, like, you know how in America, the time difference, so it's like 7 o'clock, you're waking up, and there's Premier League games on. And I always remember, like, thinking to myself, one day I want to be playing in England. Like, that's like, this is like what I want to do.
Jeez. Yeah. Well, I mean, shoot, bro. You're there. Here we go. We're about to head into the next one. Bird Dog. Okay. Starting 3, 2, 1. Here we go. Out, in, back out, switch. Here we go. So obviously, right, your mom's American, dad's from Finland. I mean, that had to be it. Was that a tough decision for you to make to play for
15 seconds.
To play for the Finnish national team or the US national team?
It was a tough decision, but at the same time, I think, because I remember telling my dad when I first came to QPR, he ended up calling me one day, and he was like, you know, like, sooner or later, you're going to get the, like, call from either national team, because you're playing for QPR now, you're going to get the call from either the national team, like, who you want to play for. And I was like, At that time, I think I was like 18, maybe 17, 18. At that time, I was thinking, like, I just got to QPR. Like, I don't need to make a decision now. And then he was kind of like to me, yeah, you obviously don't need to make a decision now, but sooner or later, if you keep progressing and playing first, once you get to playing first team for QPR, you'll most likely get called up to play for a first team, like, national team wise, either USA or Finland. And I think I remember telling him, kind of, whoever calls me up first, I'm gonna end up choosing, type of thing. And Finland ended up calling me up, and I've represented Finland under 18s, under 19s, and under 20, at the under 21 level as well. And then I did end up going to 2 camps for USA, just to see when they ended up calling me up, and just to see how it was, type of thing. And I just thought the pathway for me in a national team circumstance,
right,
was better to pick Finland for that literal reason. And because I'm playing over in Europe,
mm-hmm.
With the Finland national team, I played against France, World Cup winners. We ended up beating them. Crazy moment.
Wait.
But
Hold on. Guys, hold up. Time out. Did y'all just hear that? This guy played against France first team. Yo, play against France national team. Okay. We're gonna put a pause on this core workout for a bit. Bro, what was that like for you playing against France national team? World Cup winner, where they had literally all of their first team players, big name players.
Honestly, it was crazy. the way the whole like just obviously we trained, obviously we were in Paris, obviously, but we were training, we got to Paris maybe 2 days, three days before the game.
Right.
We ended up only training at the stadium where we're gonna play, which is like the national team stadium.
Right.
The day before the game. When I mean, I stepped like on the pitch and I was looking around. Obviously it's COVID, so there wasn't any fans, but I was looking around and I was thinking, nah, this is like the same standard as like Wembley Stadium, like maybe even better, like huge stadium. And I was just thinking, I knew I was playing against France, like I knew I was starting, so I was just thinking I'm gonna be playing against, I don't know who they're gonna play, but I'm gonna be playing against some big name players. It don't matter who they end up playing, there's gonna be big name players. And obviously, we didn't know until the day of the game who they were gonna put out against us. And when I saw Pogba and Giroud and bro, I saw all these big name players, I was thinking, okay. I was thinking, yeah, today's the day, like I need to every bit of hard work and stuff, I just need to be focused and do my thing. This is like probably the biggest game, biggest world stage I've played at for sure. And yeah, we ended up beating them 2-0 in Paris. It was crazy.
Yo, my guy, he got the dub, bro. They got the dubs 2-0, bro. And you had an excellent game in that game too, bro.
Yeah.
You played so well in that game. I mean, I was just like, it was crazy. Like hearing the score 2-0, bro, nobody could believe it.
Yeah. To be honest, after the game, I was still kind of like, everyone was celebrating and stuff, and I was thinking, bro, we just beat France. We just beat the world champions 2-0 in Paris.
Yes.
And I was thinking, God is good. Like, that's crazy.
Oh, my gosh, bro. Isn't he, man? He's amazing, bro. I mean, just looking back at your journey, bro, like, who would have thought you would be in that stadium in that moment playing against France, a kid from Florida, you know, dreamed of moments like that, and actually it happened, you know, like it's only God's plans that happened.
Literally couldn't, I don't think I would be able, like as a youngin, like when I was younger and stuff, bro, you can't, I wouldn't even be thinking like I'm gonna be playing one day, I'm gonna be playing against the world champions and we're gonna beat them and I'm gonna have an excellent game. Like, that wouldn't even go through my head. But yeah, bro, crazy. Bro,
that's just amazing. When I saw that, bro, and your Instagram went crazy that day too, huh?
Yeah, it did. Cause I was on, you know that 4-4-3-3.
Mm-hmm.
Instagram page, they have a 4-3-3, whatever, some big Instagram football page. And I remember all the international scores, and we were like, I think like me and another player had a picture like celebrating one of the goals, and then I got added on that, and it just like blew up. Everyone was just like hitting me up. No way, did you just beat France? Blah blah blah. Who'd you play against? And I, crazy.
They thought you, like, people were thinking, oh man, they just played against France, called their U21 players in. But nah, bro. They had their full gang in there.
Literally, I was playing against Sissoko.
Sissoko was in the midfield. Pogba was in the midfield. My guys, they were feeling we're getting that dub against them. But I mean, man, what a game that was! All right, yo, that's just crazy to think. I mean, to this day, like, I still think about it. I'm just like, man, that's incredible. That is something you're probably never gonna forget.
Never.
All right. Okay, guys, let's go. Let's get back into this. Right now, we got a runner sit-up. Okay? Starting in 3, 2, 1. Let's get it. Runner sit-up. Yes, sir. This is getting... I'm trying to get Niko ready for the Euros. Getting him ready. Euros 2021. Gotta qualify for that World Cup, bro.
Yes, sir. That's the next step.
3 seconds until recover. Recover for 15 seconds.
Yo, if Niko qualifies for the World Cup, guys, we're going to the World Cup.
Yeah.
We're going to the World Cup if Niko qualifies. We're going to be at the game. We're going.
We have France again in the World Cup qualifier in our group.
No way.
Yeah, bro. We played them twice. So one time in Paris, one time in Finland.
So. Pogba, Griezmann, Sissoko. If you're watching this, okay, I'm sorry. My boy Nico's coming for y'all. He's coming.
Yeah.
He's coming for y'all. Here we go. Let's go. Beast, knee to elbow. Ready? 3, 2, 1. Let's get it. So here, knee to elbow. Engage that core. All of this is really good for lower back. I've always struggled with lower back problems. And this is really good for lower back. Working on that core, staying strong.
3 seconds until recover.
There you go.
Recover for 15 seconds.
Lock done. But the crazy thing is, you played against France last year. But it wasn't always like that. It's been a journey for you, huh? It's been quite the journey. You've had a lot of success the last year, in the last year and a half, finally breaking through with the first team at QPR. But yeah. It's been a journey for you coming. You've been loaned out a couple of times. I mean, explain that. Like, what's it like to be loaned out? What's the first place you got loaned out to?
First place I got loaned out to was when I was 19 to elite two team called Dagenham and Redbridge. And I only played when I went for, I want to say a month. Yeah, a month. I only ended up playing two games, but that was like, it was kind of still a good thing, because when you're young, you want to play professional football. Like, right. Obviously, it's good to play under reserves and stuff, like games like that. But there's nothing like when you're playing professional football, when like mortgage payments are on the line, bonuses, like people are playing for something. It's not you're playing just to play and get fit and like stuff like that.
Yeah, like you're competing for points at that level.
Literally. So I think they just QPR wanted to see if I could like handle myself in a professional environment, professional level, which obviously I didn't get to play as much as I would like to, but I did my thing when I played, so can't really complain. And then after that, it was usually when you make your debut and stuff professionally, like not usually, but most cases you make your debut and then you just continue like playing type of thing. After that, it kind of like, I want to say went downhill, but it kind of just steadied. Like I didn't play until I was, didn't play a professional game until maybe I was like, I want to say 20, I don't even remember what age, maybe 20, 21 maybe. Wow. And then I finally broke through at QPR. Jimmy Fuller, House of Bank, was our manager at the time, and he liked what he saw, with me, and then just gave me, I ended up having four appearances under him before he got sacked. And then another manager came in and again didn't get my opportunity with him. They wouldn't let me go on loan anywhere. They thought I was good enough to play in the first team, but obviously not good enough, or I wasn't good enough to start, obviously, because I didn't really start or anything. But I was just in and around the first team, training, traveling to games, being on the bench, or just missing out on being on the bench and stuff like that. And then it wasn't until maybe last season when I went on loan, after I went on loan to LAFC, when I came back and went on loan to Scotland, it wasn't that until then when I really broke through into a first team environment and really played. Literally, I played since when I went there, played every single game, started every single game until obviously COVID happened. But yeah, that's like when I really have broken through into a first team. Yeah.
That's like the thing people don't understand is that, you know, when you're you know 17, 18, you're signing a contract plan at a level like QPR. People don't understand how tough it is for a young athlete. You know, not just physically, because physically, I mean, you have the ability. That's why I sign you. But then you go for like 2 years. You go for like almost 2 years without really playing. I mean, what was that like for you? Like mentally, where do you think you were at that kept you motivated, kept you going? Did you have anybody in your circle that, you know, was there for you just to guide you? I just can't even put the words how crazy that was for you, man.
Like, I'll probably say in that span of, like, I would say 2 years when I didn't, after I made my professional debut and played, then I didn't get the opportunity to play or whatever for 2 years. Literally, what kept me going was just me personally, just my mentality, just saying to myself, like, you have, like, you're good enough, you've showed you're good enough. You wouldn't be in this position still, and they wouldn't still be offering you new contracts if they didn't think you were good enough.
Right.
So it's just a matter of time. And literally, I think I remember one time I kind of, I wouldn't say broke down, but like I kind of started thinking to myself, like I'm still not getting the opportunity. I'm doing everything I can. I'm doing extras. I'm doing work outside of training. I'm doing training when I get home. Like, I'm doing more than probably these guys that are starting week in, week out are doing, but I'm still not getting my opportunity. But at the end of the day, it's literally whenever your time comes, you have to be ready for it. So literally, your mentality just has to be so, like, it's not, I tell a lot of people that ask me for advice that it's not for the weak-minded at all, because you have so much things going on, not just with soccer, just in life in general, as you get older and stuff, that go on outside of soccer, which you just need to be so mentally strong for and just ready for. Just an aspect of literally just life. Just that's besides football. Football is a whole different aspect of that.
The game. I tell people the same thing too, bro. Like, the same thing you're saying. I tell them, like, the physical side of football is the easiest part. Yeah. Going pro, the physical side is always easy because you're constantly training. You know, you're in an environment where you're constantly training. You're growing. You're growing physically. You know, but then the reason why you have a lot of young players that end up not playing anymore, end up like just like, you know, giving up or just saying, no, this is not for me and I'm done with it, is because mentally they just cannot handle it. They just can't deal with it mentally. The mental side of it is just like, it's just too much for them. And so it leads me to thinking, how is it that like we always train so much. We put everything into training, getting our bodies ready. I mean, like we beat our body to the ground just to be ready to run and play football and play 90 minutes. But we don't train our minds, and we don't train to be mentally strong to last to play 15 to 20 years of our career. Because but we were trained so hard in our body to be ready, but we never trained mentally.
Yeah, I think the higher you get, I think as well.
Right.
The more you need to be mentally strong as well, because now, say for instance, if I was to have a bad game or bad performance, or like I was to be at fault for a goal or something, if I go on social media, I'm seeing my name's everywhere. People cussing me out, saying I'm shit, saying I'm this, saying I'm that. And if you actually read into that, you're like, most people, if you're reading that, you're thinking, bro, what's this guy talking about? He don't know anything. Like, what is he talking about? What's this guy talking about? But at the same time, you're thinking like you can't actually read deep into that stuff, because that's the type of thing that will start affecting you. It'll affect you, affect your performance, affect you in training. Like, you just need to be, you need to, my mom always says it, and my dad as well, but my mom more says it, just stay on the narrow path, because if you start swerving on that pathway, you'll just, you'll lose track and focus of what, like, I'm literally in England to play football. Like, that's what my main focus is. That's why I'm here. That's what I wanted to do as a young kid. That's what I'm doing right now. And I just need to keep, no matter what goes on, you just need to stay focused and stay like level-headed about what I'm here to do, type of thing.
Nah, that's incredible, bro. That's incredible. All right, guys. Let's get back into it. So we got a toe touch to a full sit-up. Toe touch to a full sit-up. Okay. Here we go, Niko. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Let's go. Toe touch to a full sit-up. Keep that leg hover back in. Keep that leg hover. If you can come up as far, sit up as tall as you can. Keep that leg over. There you go. Flex that quad to engage the core.
3 seconds.
There we go.
Recover for 15 seconds.
Well done. All right, here we go. Getting ready. We're about to get into Nico's favorite.
3 seconds until work.
Here we go. 3, 2, here we go. Boom. Side plank, knee drive. There you go. Drive those knees. Okay, boom, bring that knee to that elbow. Excellent. Yo.
Three seconds until recover. Recover for 15 seconds.
All right. Oh man. Round one over. Round one is done. It's done for, bro. So you talked about you came in alone to LAFC. What was that like for you, coming to a franchise? Like, was that the first year they started, or was that the second year?
Second, I want to say second year.
Second year, yeah. It was the second year because they had just built that new facility, huh?
Yeah. Second year, yeah.
I mean, bro, like how was playing for LAFC and being at that facility?
I can't lie. Nothing. Like when it came about, like the option to go on to LAFC, I didn't even think twice about it. I was like, let's get it sorted out. Because obviously Bob Bradley, like, what a coach.
What a legend.
Literally, what a coach. And when he obviously had interest in me and just how they were speaking highly of me and stuff. I just thought, like, I wasn't playing at QPR, and if they would allow me to go on loan to LAFC, like, why not, type of thing. And
right.
Bro, I didn't obviously, last time I was at an MLS team or anything like that was when I was at FC Dallas.
Right.
Academy. And yeah, bro, I didn't know what to expect at first, but then when I got there and I saw, like, the facility, I'll be honest, the facility is better than QPR probably. Like, that's the standard facility. And I was like, kind of like, when I saw the training facility, I was like, whoa, like, this is nice. And then obviously the players I was playing with, some, like, good players. Carlos Vela, what a baller. Baller.
What was that like defending against that guy?
You know he's gonna chop into his left side. Like, you know he's gonna chop inside. And you force, like, and you put your body position, like, you're forcing him down the line, bro. I swear he comes, like, I don't know how, he just does it every time. Like, and if you overcommit, he'll just take it by you and then still come, like, he'll put his body in the way. So you're either fouling him or he's going, or you have to let him go inside of you, like, the other way.
That's that left foot magic, bro.
Yeah, bro, he's good. He's good.
Yeah,
I made like, obviously good friends being there. Like,
yeah.
They're probably like the best team probably in MLS, or one of the best teams in MLS.
Right. Yeah. No, they were at that time.
Yeah.
They had a great run. Sad that they couldn't get the job done.
Yeah, I know. But yeah, like, it was overall, it was a good experience for sure.
Of course, bro. Being in LA, what's better than that?
Crazy.
What's better than that? Fashion City?
Bro.
You got into a little fashion a little bit over there, huh?
Yeah. I've learned my fair share of, for sure.
The proper way to dress, bro. My guy came to LA, went back to England. Everybody, the drip guy had been like crazy when he went back after LA.
Yeah.
So here we go. Let's get into the second round. Let's get into the second round real quick. All right, ready? Here we go. Starting in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Here we go. Show the tags. So, what is your go-to post, like, pre-workout and post-workout meal? So before training, what do you usually eat?
I'll be honest. I started. So from the beginning of this season,
right,
I started not eating anything before training. Almost like a fasting type of thing. Before, literally, obviously, I drink water and stuff.
But right.
Food wise, I won't eat anything until after training. But
why? What made you do that?
I don't know. I feel sharper when I'm like, to be honest, one of the things, I get to sleep longer. second reason is I've actually a couple of the players do it, but I just feel sharp. Like when I was training after eating, so I get to training. The chef or the chefs will make like our breakfast, whatever. We'll eat, then we'll have whatever amount of time before training and stuff. I don't know. I felt like not as sharp. I felt kind of heavy, I guess, type of thing.
Mm.
And now I literally will just be like hydrated, and I feel so sharp running around. Like I feel sharp. And I'm not losing weight, not losing muscle mass. So, yeah.
Wow. No, I mean, I've heard a couple of people say that too. I usually try to eat something. I don't eat heavy. I eat like a little oatmeal
before training,
right? Like an hour before training. But by the time training starts, you know, I'm empty.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. Here we go. Starting in 3, 2, 1. Here we go. Single leg drops.
Oh, that one.
Yeah, single leg drops. And then so what's your go-to meal after training? Usually you guys have a chef that cooks, or do you make
something? Chef at the training ground, at the training facility. There's usually a mixture of like different like maybe 2-3 different vegetables. And then there'll be 2-3 different protein, either fish, chicken, or chickpea, or like some type of vegetarian type of protein, and then fish and chicken. But usually there's like just 3 portions of 3 different stations of like different vegetables, different chicken, different carbs. Usually varies on the game, like when our next game is. It'll vary on how much like carbs and stuff they put out.
Oh, okay.
Literally, like say today we had training. Our next game Saturday. We had a game Tuesday. Our next game Saturday. Today, after training, I had chicken, rice, vegetables, and then 1 boiled egg or deviled egg, whatever you call it, and then some salami on the side. So, not that much rice, because I don't really need to have a lot of carbs in me right now. Tomorrow, obviously before the game and stuff, I'll eat a bunch of carbs. But yeah, it just varies. My diet kind of varies to when the game is, type of thing.
Got it. All right, here we go, bird dog. 3, here we go, we're working. Back in, out. Okay. Oh, yo. So what's 3 meals you would recommend to anyone that's never been to England? I definitely know one of them.
Yeah, I think everyone knows one. fish and chips, for sure.
3 seconds until recovered. I wasn't thinking about that.
Oh, you wasn't thinking about that?
Nope.
All right, so you have to try fish and chips, because I think it's good personally. When I have it, I think it's good. Nando's.
That's the one I'm talking about.
You know it. Nando's.
You gotta have some Nando's. You have to have that.
I might have it tonight, I can't lie. I'll be honest.
Oh my, yo. I'm so jealous right now, Niko. I'm so jealous right now. My goodness.
Nando's is fire, I can't lie.
Yo, explain to these people what Nando did. Like, explain to them, because, like, I don't know if I can really give them the full explanation of what it is.
I'll probably say, all right, literally, Nando's is like, I don't want to say it's Spanish, because it's not Spanish. It's like Portuguese, I think. But yeah. It's literally just chicken and whatever sides you can think of, rice.
And some nice Nando in the sauce.
Bro, the sauce on the chicken. it's fire. It's actually fire.
Yo.
It's so good.
Bro, I'm literally drooling right now. I'm drooling right now for some Nando's right now. I could go for it.
I can't lie. I'm having it tonight because of this conversation. I can't lie.
Bro, I'm – yo. my gosh. All right, so we got fish and chips. We got Nando, like, amazing. What else?
There's a spot I go to. It's not for everyone. It's if you like seafood, it's a spot, but it's called Burger and Lobster.
Ooh, I love seafood.
It's literally like when I go, that's like kind of like my cheat day type of meal. On a day off or something, I'll go. But it's literally a big platter. It's a pound and a half of lobster, a five ounce burger, and a salad, like a side salad and a side of French fries, bro.
I love how they put the side salad.
Yeah.
to make you feel like you're healthy.
Literally, it's just there. Sometimes I don't even touch it, but
no chance.
Then they have this fire, like, side of garlic butter sauce.
Oh my gosh,
it's so fire. Every time my mom comes, every time my family comes, that's like the first place they want to go because it's just fire.
Yo, bro. Oh my god, bro. I'm literally here we go. We're about to do the runner sit-ups. Bro, I'm thinking about Nando's right now. I'm definitely gonna, I need to come back to England. Here we go. Runner sit-ups. My gosh. Guys, you don't understand. I could literally go for some Nando's right now. Honestly.
Yeah, I'm having some after.
Runner sit-ups. Thinking about him. All right. What is three plays right now that you really miss about the U.S.? Three plays.
3 seconds until recover.
Three places?
Yes. Three food or three places in the U.S. or in Miami that you miss right now.
Okay. First one. I'm just going to say being by the beach, because you can't go wrong with that.
Yeah.
Second one. What? I'll probably say it's called Benny's on the Beach. It's a restaurant on the beach in Lake Worth.
Woo!
Bro, they have the best cheese shrimp grits. Oh my goodness.
What? I'm not really a big fan of grits. But
bro, so good.
For you people out there that like grits, make sure when you're in Miami, hit that place up. What's it called?
Benny's on the Beach.
Benny's on the Beach.
Yeah, bro.
All right.
And then last one, I'll probably say, bro, I don't even know. Just being in South Beach, probably, I'll probably say. Just like walking around, like, all the good vibes, people.
Yeah,
you can't go wrong with it.
Nah, bro, like, chill. The, what you call it? Bro, I mean, just like the Cuban food.
Yeah,
the,
bro.
Is there a lot of Jamaican restaurants where you're at?
In London, yeah, there is actually. There's a lot of Jamaican and African, like, heritage over here. So I'll be,
yeah.
Bro, I'll be eating a lot of jollof.
Ah!
Bro, I'll like at least once a week, I'm eating jollof. I swear.
Yeah. This guy is eating jollof. Yo, hey, I'm going to tell you the secret why Nico's playing really well right now. Okay? I'm going to tell you the secret. It's not because of no Nando. It's not because of anything else. This guy is eating jollof once a week. Once a week. That is the secret of, like, dude, this guy, listen, his parents might have, you know, his dad might be from Finland. He might be living in England. But this guy has some real African blood going in his veins right now because he's eating jollof. He's eating jollof once a week.
Bro, it's fire. There's a couple guys that play for QPR that one of my close boys, or two, three of my close boys, two of them's from Nigeria, and then one of them's Nigerian and one of them's from Sierra Leone.
Oh,
and then my other boy is Ghanaian.
Oh my people, what a
hug. I have all of those.
Is there, I'm sure you hear this every single time. They talk about my country have the best jollof.
Yeah, all the time, bro. They're always saying, nah, my country does the best jollof, blah, blah, blah. Like, nah. They always, like, just, to be honest, I've tasted one from my boys and one from my other boys, Nigerian and Ghanaian. I've tasted both.
Okay. All right. Hold on. All right. We're about to set the record straight right now. All right, people, listen. So, Nico's about to be the judge of this, right? Nico, be honest to the people. Who have the best jollof? Nigerians or Ghanaians?
I'm going to be honest.
Be honest, bro.
Ghanaians.
Yo, you hear it right now. You hear it. You said Ghanaian have the best jollof. I'm sorry to my Niger people. I'm sorry. The man said the Chale has the best jollof. Not Naja. I'm sorry.
Yeah, bro.
Oh my gosh. Well, hey, at least we have an outsider that, you know, that thinks that Ghanaian have the best jollof.
Yeah.
We will see what the people think. Let me know what y'all think. Who have the best jollof? Ghanaians or Nigerians? All right, here we go. Let's get into it. Let's get into the beast, knee to elbow. Okay. Man, this guy eating jollof every week. No wonder why you're killing it over there, bro. Here we go. Knee to elbow. Yo, I'm telling you. If you wanna start killing it right now, start eating jollof. That's what I need to start doing more. I don't eat enough jollof.
Bro, I told my mom knows a Ghanaian lady, and she gave my mom the recipe to make jollof. Bro, my mom makes it all the time now.
Bro, I'm telling you guys, jollof is like a secret rice full of love. You're good, Nico. It's full of love, full of, I'm telling you, you don't understand.
That's super good.
People fight over this kind of stuff. Countries, listen, the reason why countries don't like each other in West Africa is because of jollof, not because of money. Right?
They're always competing. Who makes the best one?
Who makes the best jollof? I'm telling you. That's the competition in West Africa, man. I'm telling you. Who makes the best jollof? That's the competition. And it ain't about no money or infrastructure, none of that. It's about jollof. It's about rice. You touch another African jollof. Oh, you better catch them hands. I'm telling you, it's no joke. It is no joke. You touch another person's jollof, it's no joke. You better catch them hands. All right, here we go. Toe touch to a full sit up. Ready? Starting in 3, 2, 1. Let's get working. Bro, that is crazy. I mean, yo. Hey, you definitely got to make that trip to Ghana, bro.
For sure.
It's this Ghana is a good place to be too, especially around December, Christmas time. The vibes there is great. I mean, I had the pleasure of living in Ghana for a bit. I love going back. I've only been back once since I've been to the US. I'm definitely trying to go back again. So hopefully I get to go back.
Yeah, I think one of my boys as well. He just made his debut for Senegal national team, first team. And bro, he was saying Senegal was nice. Like,
Senegal is beautiful.
Like, he was talking about like buying properties and stuff when he came back because of how nice it was and stuff. Yeah.
Nah, that's Senegal is a place I want to go visit too. I really want to go visit Senegal.
Yeah, I think I need to take a trip over there for sure.
Nah, bro, for sure, 100%, 100%. So what's your game day tunes right now? Five artists that you love listening to right now.
Oh. You know, I have to put Florida Boy straight in first. First person, I'll put straight in. Rod Wave, hands down. I'll put him. I listen to that guy too much, I think. Too much. But yeah, Rod Wave first. I'll probably say G Herbo.
Okay.
Yeah, G Herbo. I've been rocking with him.
I'm telling you guys, this guy loves their Florida people, man.
Yeah, bro. I'm gonna put in third Kodak, obviously. I'll probably say fourth. I'll probably say Polo G.
Okay, all right.
And then that's hard. Last one's hard. There's too many, so many artists. Probably say Meek Mill.
Oh, okay, all right.
But like usually it's literally like Rod Wave, like on the way to the stadium, Rod Wave. When I get to the stadium, G Herbo, those two.
All right. Let's get into the last one. Last one. Here go your favorite one.
My favorite.
Your favorite. Here we go. 3, 2, 1. Let's go. Here we go. Almost there, baby. Woo.
3 seconds until recover.
Yes, sir.
Done.
There we go. Workout's done. That wasn't so bad.
Nah, it wasn't that bad.
All right. Okay. You ready? Rapid questions. You gotta answer and just boom right away. Okay. Just cool. One. Okay. Game winning goal or game winning assist?
Game winning goal.
Cleats or flats?
Cleats.
Chicken or steak?
Steak.
Call or text?
Call.
Win a Grammy or win an Oscar?
Grammy.
World Cup? Win a World Cup or win a Champions League?
World Cup.
Shorts or sweats?
Shorts.
Cardio or weights?
Cardio.
All right. Okay. Wait. Oh my gosh, dude. I meant to ask this. I think I remember you telling me this a while ago. I think it was when your mom took us to that Cheesecake Factory. Like it was when we're at SNL. The story of how your mom and dad met. What's that story? I think that story is amazing. If I remember well.
They like telling people this story. Obviously, I would too, but still. So basically, my mom was born and raised in San Francisco. She moved to Miami when she was maybe 27. I want to say around 27, maybe. And then my dad, obviously born and raised in Finland, moved to Miami when he was, I want to say 26, 27 as well. Around the same time they moved there. Obviously, they have no idea who they are. There's no Tinder back then. There's no there's no Instagram. They don't know anything about each other. Anyway, my dad stopped playing football or whatever, soccer. He ended up being an elevator engineer, working for Schindler Elevator Company. And he was like the manager of the Miami Schindler Elevator District, whatever. So anyway, he was working on an elevator. And obviously, he was 27, so he's walking around, shirt off, big guy. And then my mom ended up living in the apartment complex or apartment place that my dad was working on the elevator in. And my dad basically like saw my mom come out her door to go to like one of the other elevators that was in the building. And instead of him like going over to her like with his shirt off, like looking all like big and like trying to like show out, he ended up putting his shirt on, like respectfully putting his shirt on, and literally like walked up to my mom. And he's obviously still kind of has that like Finnish fresh accent, like he doesn't speak English like that. So he was just like started speaking to my mom, and they literally just kind of went from there, kind of thing.
The reason it's just crazy, because usually it's the opposite way with like, you know, interracial couples, where like you have either a black guy dating a white woman, but this time, you know, like you have, it's a white guy with a black woman, and that's something that you don't usually see. And so it's very different. And you know, I mean, it's just crazy, you know, for that to happen. I have so much respect, and I'm sure your parents have went through their fair share of like some craziness.
Yeah, for sure. I know for sure they have. But, and my mom has told me something. But
I think that story is incredible. But yo, dude, thank you so much. Thank you so much for coming on. The conversation has been great.
No problem.
I really appreciate it. Good luck with your upcoming games in the World Cup. Definitely be tuning in. How can people follow you? How can people follow you and keep up with you?
Best is just follow my Instagram. I'm pretty sure it's Niko, N-I-K-O underscore A-H. And that's probably the best way.
Yeah. All right, guys. Yo, thank you all so much for tuning in. Great to have my bro in here. Me and this guy, we go way back. It's God's blessings and God's plans of like where him and I were, like where we're at now in our life and the success that we've had. It's no surprises of why we're here. Honestly, it's just the grace of God that we're here, because you know, I can tell you that we've both been through a lot, and we've come very far, and it's just God's blessing. So before I end this, I would like to finish my sentence for me, all right, Niko? All right. Niko will consider his career as a success if he...
That's hard, bro.
It's difficult.
If he plays more than 100 games in the Premier League.
Put it up. Plays more than 100 games in the Premier League. Yeah. All right. Now, I think that's a successful story right there.
Yeah.
This is difficult. Guys, you understand it's difficult to play in the Premier League. It's difficult.
It's
a milestone if you can get to 100.
Yeah, bro. Just to play like one season is crazy. But yeah, if I was able to play at least 100 appearances in the Premier League, that would be a blessing for sure.
Yeah. All right, guys. Thank you, guys. Much love. Follow Niko on Instagram. Follow us on Core Conversation on YouTube. Subscribe. Make sure you follow us on Instagram as well. All right. See ya. Thank you.